Good morning. We will start the lecture soon, so please turn on your camera. Oke, terima. Oke, thank you. sorry. I'm sorry that I haven't finished your midterm exam marking yet. I'm working on it now, and as soon as it's available, I'll announce the result on Microsoft Teams, probably somewhere or sometimes next week. Okay. Let's start with our lecture today. Today's topic is about security. Okay. Now that we already into our second years, in a few months we will enter into the third years, perhaps, hopefully not, that we were confined to our home and working from home, we depend a lot on using information technology. if you remember, last year when we start to underwent the work or school from home regimen, I think you still remember, suddenly we were forced to use our computer more intensively. We depend more on internet connection. Okay. And then we depend so much more on application like Microsoft Teams, Zoom, Google Meet, and any other application that help us work from home or school from home. And in itself has created many problems. However, if you still remember, early on, the most popular application for video meeting, Zoom, was having quite a nasty problem. It's called the phenomenon as a Zoom bombing, where uninvited attendants can join a Zoom meeting and create a lot of disturbance. For example, in Singapore, in I think it was junior high, where there were a lot of students still underage. Somebody joined the Zoom meeting of a classroom there, or a few classrooms, and then started to share pornographic materials that unsuited for minor children underage. There was a doctoral defense meeting, so in the US, so one of the PhD candidate in the US defense her thesis in front of the exam panels using Zoom, obviously, and then somebody entered the room unauthorized and creating disturbance so much so that the thesis exam have to be stopped. Can you imagine to be that PhD student that has been working very hard? Most of PhD student in US working very, very hard for maybe 5 to 6 years to produce a thesis, then it's just one step away from being graduated as a doctor. And yet, in that critical final moment, somebody create problem for her, so she could not continue. And then another example was the leak of users or customer data of Tokopedia. Fortunately, at that time, the person who able to obtain the data could not open the data. So it was still in unreadable form. I'll show you later what I meant by that. Okay. So we were at that time we were fortunate. If you were one of the Tokopedia user, that even though the data leaked to the public, nobody can read it. Okay, I'll show you how Tokopedia and any other institution in the world to secure their data. Okay, but in itself, that the data can be stolen was a bad thing. Okay. And the threats of information technology security is not always the domination of big company or enterprises. The danger lurk around us at home. Let me share my screen. Okay, is it visible? Can you see the slide?
Yes, sir, already.
Okay, thank you. So yeah, so I think some of you, and I believe all of you have smartphone, right? There's a danger in smartphone. We will discuss that later. But plenty of smartphone physically has been stolen. And the content of that smartphone, something that private and only for the consumption of people close to you, has been leaked to the public. Many years ago, the mobile phone, I think it was iPhone at that time, from few Hollywood celebrities were hacked and their private pictures being shared on the internet. The perpetrator has been arrested, has been tried, and has been convicted, and I think currently serving time in prison. But the damage has been done. Those private pictures already run wild over the internet. Okay. Well, some new parents, I don't know if you already have a baby or not, I don't think so, but some parents use this baby monitor for monitoring their baby in their room. Probably it's not that common in Indonesia because in Indonesia, usually babies sleep with their parents. But in many Western countries, babies sleep on their own room. Okay. And the parents could monitor them using this baby monitor. Some baby monitor were connected to the internet. So the parent, whenever they travel, they can check on their baby. Smart TV, probably all of you already have smart TV in your own home. Smart TV is basically small computers with large screen. So it's basically just computer. Okay. And any computer can be hacked. CCTV, security cam. Some internet provider company offer the package where they can install CCTV in your home and you can monitor your home if you were away using your mobile phone like this picture, for example. Okay. Okay, there is another threat. Somebody could hijack this CCTV, and it get from spying your activities at home until using that CCTV to do some crime. I'll tell you later about it. I believe if you subscribe to internet connection at home, you will have this route, this kind of router for your Wi-Fi at home. Again, a lot of people can do unauthorized activities with your router. And it recently become more popular, the smart speaker. Okay. Like Apple HomePod, Google smart speaker, and they use Siri, Google Now, or Alexa, for example. Alexa is quite popular, that they are available in many homes. Okay, I don't think they are popular now in Indonesia, but who knows in the future. So why systems are vulnerable? Before we go into that part, there are some definition that we need to know. First, security. Security is policies, procedures, and technical measure used to prevent unauthorized access. So it's to prevent unauthorized access. For example, password. Or if you using your smartphone, you can use if it's Apple computer, if it's Apple mobile phone, for example, iPhone, you can use Face ID. Samsung can use your retinal scan for opening, or use fingerprints. For example, this is my mobile phone. Return to this. If you can see, there is a fingerprint here. Okay. I can unlock it using my fingerprint. Okay. This kind of security. Okay. Why? Because I want to restrict access to my mobile phone. Alteration. Some crimes did not involve stealing something, but they alter the information. Okay, they alter the data. That can create a lot of problem. Theft, obviously, either digital theft, like they stealing data, they stealing property right products like books, film, movies, Lego, not Lego, songs, or they can steal physical products like smartphone, laptop, things like that. And also to create physical damage to information system, sabotage, things like that. Controls. Controls is methods, policy, and organizational procedures that ensure safety of organization assets, accuracy and reliability of its accounting records, and operational adherence to management standards. You already learned this in accounting information system. So why system or information system are vulnerable? First, accessibility of networks. Every device or every things that can be connected to the internet inherently will have vulnerabilities. Your smart speaker, your smart TV, for example. Let me give you this. If you own a smart TV, in my case it is Samsung, unknown to, you know, it's behind the screen, behind all the visible things, smart products, or the current term is Internet of Things, can send or receive data without our knowledge. Let me give you this example. Okay, let me share you this. Can you see the screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, oops. Okay, so okay, if you look at this, this is a top block domain. So I put some kind of a device to observe the network at my home. And as you can see, so this one, for example, Samsung Cloud Solution.net, Samsung QBE.com. These two came from the smart TV. So the smart TV sent something or contacted Samsung server Netflix, obviously, because it's streaming services. This one is from Xiaomi. I have Xiaomi devices at my home, and it sent data, even Microsoft. Okay, so it was blocked. With this Google here, for example, this is for advertising. Okay. So unknown to us, at least in visible eyes, those devices contacted their, let's just say, their producers and send some data. I don't know what kind of data and I don't want to know. That's irrelevant to me. But I don't really like that they did something behind my back, so I block it. Okay. Okay. And if some electronic devices could send and receive something unknown to you, what are the chances that somebody intentionally broke into your home network and did the same thing, stealing your data? There are plenty of things. You probably remember or ever see a picture of Mark Zuckerberg, you know, the founder of Facebook, on his working desk and his laptop. On the top of that laptop, there were a camera, and he put a tape on that camera to close the lenses. Even Mark Zuckerberg felt that it was unsecured. Okay, and Facebook is one of the company that creating this insecurity. Okay, so accessibility. As long as you connected to the internet, there's always danger alerts. Hardware problems. Okay, hardware itself can fail. The failure can be caused by the flaw in their original design. Old age. You know, if you have something that have been used for 10 years or so, it will break someday. Configuration errors or electricity problems. Okay. Natural disaster and any matter. Software problem. Okay. Programming errors, the software itself has flaw. Installation error, when you install the software, there is something that missing, or unauthorized changes. You change something that should not be changed. Disaster, you know, okay. Use of network or computer outside of firm's control. I don't think you were, have you attended the class recently? Have you opted to attend the offline classes this semester? Not yet? Okay, so before the pandemic, whenever the student use computers facility in our campuses, doesn't really create problems. because the computers in our campus has been set up for security. Okay. However, since last year, we were forced to use the campus network, like the kuliah site and any the library, okay, Microsoft Teams outside the campus, and that's create a lot of problem. I'll show you where. Okay. And this one, the last one, loss and theft of portable devices. That happens a lot. You know, I've been misplaced my mobile phone. So when I fly, it was the time that I returned from my trip to Jakarta, and I went through the security check before I boarded the plane. I put my mobile phone on the tray and going to the X-ray, and I forgot to pick it up. Okay, because it was in a rush. Somebody stole my mobile phone a few years later. Again, it's possible. Okay. The problem with the portable devices, usually it contains personal data, privacy data. Not necessarily something that indecent, but for example, it contains the information about your address. It contains information about your internet banking account, the username, the password, you know. It contains personal data like pictures, for example. Few years ago, some journalists have his account hacked by, I don't know, and the hacker erased all the photo galleries. Okay. Look, if it's just the mobile phone or the laptop or the tablet being stolen, the price of the laptop, mobile phone or tablet, well, sure, it's expensive, but you know, just by saving, you can buy a new one. But what if the one that lost was pictures from event in the past? Okay. And that time, the journalist had the pictures from his daughter's fifth birthday in the devices, and he hasn't have time to back it up, so it lost. You know, you can't repeat a birthday party. You can't repeat all the event in that birthday party. So without the picture, it's lost. Okay. So here's where the threat and kind of threats that threaten the information systems. From the user side, there are unauthorized access errors. When you communicate with your organization systems, like when you use kuliah site or you use library facilities, there is tapping, sniffing, message alteration. Okay. Inside the server itself, there is a hacking, malware, theft and fraud, vandalism, denial of service, like we will discuss some of this. Inside the system, the theft of data, copying data, and so on and so forth. The one thing that our university is kept quiet good is the integrity of academic data. As far as I know, there hasn't been any successful attempt to change grade, for example. So if you got C and then you can hack into the university system and change that to A, I haven't heard that. Okay. So, and that's important for us as the university, because it shows that our academic records are having good integrity and secure. Okay. internet vulnerabilities. Once you connected to the internet, you open your environment to anyone. Okay. And with the size of the internet, means abuses can have wide impacts. And it's not just technical, you know, social abuses like bullying, cyberbullying, the spread of misinformation and fake news, uses of fixed internet address, cable or DSL modems, the one that we had in our home usually, create fixed target for hackers. Unencrypted voice communication. Luckily, in the last few years, all the companies that use the create products for our internet usage has been using encryption, starting from browser, Microsoft Edge, Google Chrome, Mozilla Firefox, they use encryption. Okay. Interception, attachment, malicious software, you know, you open attachment and it apparently a virus that can wreak havoc in your system. Okay. And also transmitting trade secrets. Remember, I tell a story about Zoom earlier on this lecture. Okay. So Zoom problem was not only somebody unauthorized can join the meeting and then create problems, but also it was revealed at that time that the traffic of Zoom, so when we had video meeting using Zoom, the traffic was routed through China. So it means that it goes through servers owned by Chinese companies or even Chinese government. And that creates a lot of concern. Why? Because Chinese government, the mainland Chinese, the People's Republic of China, was not known for their respect of privacy. Okay, so that can be a problem. Wi-Fi. Okay. Wi-Fi is one of the most insecure communication media. I already told you this when we discussed the network and telecommunication. Okay. People could access your, not your Wi-Fi, but people could access public Wi-Fi. So if you were using public Wi-Fi, like in the mall, cafe, restaurants, or hotels, be aware. Don't use that Wi-Fi for any sensitive activities like internet banking, for example. Okay. Somebody could snoop on or tapping your communication. In our campuses, the Wi-Fi is quite secure. Why? Because you have to log in twice. And it was created with security in mind. So it's quite secure. I'm not saying it 100% secure, but it's reasonably secure. You remember this from our discussion in telecommunication. So this is the first threat, the malicious software. There are viruses, swarm, Trojan horse, and spyware. Okay, you probably have heard computer viruses. You probably have been infected by one or affected by one. Okay, so there are plenty of. That's why any computers need to have some sort of antivirus and or anti malware installed. Okay, to keep it secure. Trojan horse, a software that looks like a legitimate software, but inside that software. Hidden another malicious software. Okay, and this usually came from unreputable software sources. So if you want to get software, get it from reputable sources. Like for example, don't use pirated software. Okay. Because the people who provide pirated software might put some malware inside it. Ransomware, this recently become popular. Ransomware is a piece of software that a malware actually that when infected your computer, it will encrypt the data inside your computer. And then it will give you notification. You will be contacted. You can't open your file because it was locked using encryption. And the people who's created ransomware will contacted you for ransom. That's why it's called ransomware. You need to pay that ransom, usually in cryptocurrency for forms. And then after you paid, you will get the key to open. Earlier, ransomware in the early days usually attack a hospital, and they lock the medical records with encryption. Okay, so you can imagine a lot of patients could not be treated because their medical record has been locked. Recently, a friend of mine also get this ransomware that he's a lecturer that. In a university nearby our campuses, I could not tell you where. There are spyware, special software designed to spy on you. Okay. There are some spyware that legitimately used by employer, Keylogger, for example. Some employer install Keyloggers on the company-owned computers. To monitor the employee, okay, what did they do with company-owned computers? And that's fine as long as the employees were informed. So the company need to make that clear that they monitor the usage. If you use computing facilities at our campuses, either it's computers or internet connection, be aware that your activities were monitored. It would be monitored by Information System Office. Why? It's because to prevent unauthorized usage. If you use, we will discuss that later. And people who committed the computer crimes is usually called hackers. But hackers is actually having a pejorative process. So it used to be a hacker is a person that tinker with computers for various purposes. For example, to make it faster, to make it better, to make it last longer, things like that. But then it evolved to name a person that tinker with computer for negative purposes or criminal motivation. Few years ago, some good hackers proposed to the Oxford English Dictionary to add crackers. So hackers is somebody who tinker with computers, and crackers is somebody who tinkers with computers, so or hackers with criminal intention. But the Oxford English Dictionary rejected that proposal. So now when we call hackers, they usually have negative connotation. Okay. So what the activities of hacker? There are system intrusion, entering the system without authorization and unknown to the owner, create damage to the system, or cyber vandalism. For example, changing the website of a company using other pictures. There was one hacker at that time hacked into the Indonesian police website, and he changed the Indonesian police most wanted poster with the picture of one of the member of the parliament. Okay, spoofing, sniffing. Now, denial of service attack. Denial of service attack is kind of attack that not really obvious. It means it looks like a usual activities, ordinary activities. So what denial of service attack does, the hackers will send data or request to the server so many or so much that the server could not handle it. So for example, the server could handle 1,000 users at a time. So the hacker will create attack that simulate 2,000 users. Because the server's only able to handle 1,000 users, if it was attacked with 2,000 users, the server will just give up and stop serving. Okay. Distributed denial of service attack is denial of service attack, but using many computers from many sources. Remember, I told you about the CCTV early on. Okay. So there was an attack to Google. Google was number one among the top target for that. So Google was attacked using the distributed denial of service attack. So as many as 150 something computers attacking Google by sending data. How much data? Google actually take a measurement, and it was one of the biggest attack ever happened to any network in history. It's amount up to almost 3 terabyte per second. So it's just like throwing 3 1-terabyte hard drive to Google every second. So it is 1 hour, 360 times 3 terabyte. Okay. If it's not Google, you know, if it our university network, for example, it will stop working. But because it's Google, they have the technology, they have the capacity, they can withstand that attack. Okay. So where the computers that attack Google came from? They actually came from CCTV. So smart CCTV, modern CCTV, is actually small computer with camera. Okay. So the hacker actually infect the CCTV, the computer inside CCTV, using a malware, and that's called create botnets. So he control the computer in CCTV, and then probably using video recorded by that CCTV, send it to attack Google. Another computer crime is identity theft. You probably aware that recently a lot of online credit company has been in troubles. Some people using other people's identity to take a loan on that. For example, somebody stole my ID to take a loan in a online credit company, Pinjol. And then that online credit company will come to me to collect payment. I don't know about that. I didn't know that I take a loan, so why should I pay? Okay. And then the most serious of computer crime is cyber terrorism and cyber warfare. And it's actually happening, especially cyber warfare between countries. So it's probably quite rare that in modern era that countries will go to war or having war with other countries, physical war, but cyber warfare is happening every day. Okay. So state-sponsored hacker teams will hack into other country computer system and create problems. The US actually having this problem early on, early this year. So some hackers actually able to penetrate the system. I think it's, I can't remember the name of the company, but it was the company that distributed fuel. So they shut down the fuel distribution system and create fuel shortage in the US. Okay, so, and the US cyber institution said that it was hackers sponsored by China, Chinese government. However, as you may remember in accounting information system, the biggest threat for any system is actually from internal, from the employees. Is some employees are actually having a bad intention, fraud, if you can remember that. Okay, they actually intend to break the system or hack into the system, and it's easy because they have access and also they understand the weaknesses of the system. Okay, and they exploit their knowledge. However, not all employees were having criminal intention. Now, some of them actually only sloppy, especially with security procedures. They use company's computers, and when they need to go to the bathroom, they left the computers unlocked. Or they left a flash drive, USB flash drive, containing company's data laying around unguarded. Many years ago in Indonesian branch of IBM, whenever an employee left a disk, floppy disk, nowadays probably flash disk, on their desk unattended, the owner of that desk will get suspension, unpaid suspension, for 2 weeks at least. Okay. Why? Because they always assume that diskette or flash disk could contain sensitive information about company. So it should be kept in a locked cupboard at least, or brought by the employee, not left unattended. Okay. So sloppy scripters, or some user don't want to remember password, so they just write down their password and put it on post-it note somewhere. Another threat from employees called social engineering. Social engineering is using social skills, communication, persuasion, to fool the employees to give the hacker access. You probably remember the text message that your mother were asking for phone credit, you know, or somebody called that asking for money because they were arrested by the police. I actually had one many years ago when my daughter was still in primary school. So somebody called my house. Okay, I wasn't at my house, and saying that my daughter was having accident, her head was hit with something, or she was slip and hit the head, and currently unconscious, were in a hospital, and need to be good for surgery, and the doctor asking for down payment of that for that operation, and the caller identify herself as Buya Yu, and I know for a fact that all my daughter teachers in that schools, nobody named Ibu Buya Yu, so I know that this is a fraud. Also recently, just few weeks ago, my home phone, I have a home phone, yeah, landline, that rarely use, was suddenly went off, and when I take that phone, somebody was crying and screaming and called me that I'm arrested by the police, please help. Funny things was, I didn't know that I have another daughter, because my daughter, my only daughter, was standing beside me at the time. So I know that this is some scam. So, you know, this kind of things. Okay. Not using advanced technical knowledge like a hacker, but fooling the user to reveal them. So for example, asking their password, you know, and some user actually able to be fooled and give them the password. The software itself has vulnerability. There is no software that 100% secure or 100% perfect. There's always flaw, there's always bug, there's always vulnerabilities. Okay. And that's just natural. The problem is finding that bug, defect, or flaws as soon as possible, and then create a patch for them. Patch is a small piece of software to repair the flaw. Okay. Microsoft, for example, every Wednesday on the second week of the month, they will release update for their software. Okay, so if you have Microsoft product, every Wednesday, every second Wednesday of the month, just click that update button. Okay, and then Microsoft will give you the list of software that we can update it on your computer. And that's a good practice. Okay. Okay. Now, why companies need to pay attention to security and control? Let me give you this illustration. Okay. Let's have some discussion, so it's not just me. Then. Jonathan, Reginald, where are you?
Yes, sir.
Okay. You have bank account, right?
Yes.
Okay. Do you utilize internet banking?
Not very much.
Okay, but you do have internet banking.
Yes.
Okay. What if your bank, just don't name the bank, announce one day that their system being hacked and all the customer money has been robbed using internet banking? Will you still using that bank?
Yeah, I would not.
Okay, good. That's my point. Okay, let's see. Lovely Davina. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so just imagine that you graduated, okay, with your accounting degree, and you want to go to a master degree, okay, and you find a university that, you know, quite reasonable, affordable, but then you know that their student can change their mark by hacking into the system. Will you go to that university?
I don't think so.
Good. That's just a waste of time and money, right? Because, you know, general society, our community, our other people will not believe the transcript. Our university is actually, you know, our program is actually having good reputation. So if you graduated from accounting program in Atmajaya and having a good transcript, people still trust that transcript. Few years ago, this is my personal experience. Few years ago, I met with few people that graduated from other accounting program. It's near our campuses. I just can't say which one. You probably can guess. They graduated with GPA almost 4. So almost perfect. But then, when I asked them basic question about accounting, they could not answer. One of them actually were selected for probation. So we give them probation for 3 months and he failed. He could not understand how the process from transaction goes into journal, because we did everything manually back then. It was 10 years ago. From transaction to journals to general ledger and then to financial report. just didn't understand it. And yet he got almost 3.95, I guess, if I'm not mistaken, GPA. Okay. I don't know whether they have problem with their academic. Okay, but let's get back to our topic. So, if a company doesn't really pay attention to their system security, nobody will trust the information produced by that system. Jonathan will not have any business with the bank that can be easily hacked into. Lovely Davina will not go into a university that, you know, the student can change their mark easily. Right, because the information being produced by their system is just garbage. Okay. So that's the point of this. Okay. Okay, let's continue. Okay. You can also have your trade secrets being stolen. Look, trade secrets will be known to public eventually. For example, the secret ingredients of Coca-Cola. With modern technology, you can actually find out what's the secret ingredients. Okay. The spices of KFC. Well, okay, with modern technology, the same technology being used for detecting COVID-19 virus can be used to detect what's in KFC chicken. It's all will be known eventually. But if you have new product, you have new strategy that you expect will help you in the short term, like a year or so, and it was known by stolen by your competitor, they can beat you to the market. Okay. And there are a lot of regulatory requirements for electronic records management. For example, in Indonesia, this is all this regulation in the US. But in Indonesia, for example, for financial transaction, the data should be kept for 10 years, and that's a requirement from taxation office. And there is the Information and Electronic Transaction Act, or ETA, that the popular name. It's actually have some clauses that regulate data management, although it's not specific for them. And currently, I think there is a initiative to create regulation protecting privacy of data. Okay. Electronic evidence. What's the problem with electronic evidence? Pierre. Have you ever copied a file, be it in a document, song, or movie?
Sorry, sir.
Have you ever copied a file, maybe a document, maybe a song, maybe a movie?
Yes.
Okay, good. Let's take song. Okay. Can you tell the difference between the original song and the one that you copied?
No.
Okay, good. That's the point. Even with document. For example, all the lecture slides I uploaded, that I uploaded to Kuliah.org, given to you. You download it. Download is basically copying something from the servers, right? Because the original file still exists in the server. Can you differentiate that between the one version in your computers with the one on the servers? Is there any visible differences? No. Okay. What if, for example, today's slide is actually having 42 pages, and for example, I change this. Okay, can you see it? Can you see the slide now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Good. Okay. Okay. Good. What if I just delete the S here? Okay. So this is the version on this on my computer and the version on the servers. Will you able to tell the differences? No, you know, without knowing that I deleted the S letter. Very hard. It's very difficult. And that's the problem with digital document or digital files. To the naked eye, the original file and the copied file will not be that different. And that's actually the advantage of digital files. Back when I was in high school, whenever I could not buy a cassette for, you know, that music usually sold in a cassette. Ask your parents, they probably can tell you. Whenever I could not buy, and one of my friends actually having the cassette, I will borrow that and I'll make a copy. But the copy will not as good as the original. In fact, if it has been copied many times, the quality of the sound actually degrading. You know. So, you know, some heavy metal band could sounds like gamelan things, you know, because it's just degrading. But with digital files, doesn't really matter. The original and the copy will have the same identical quality. And that's become a problem. Because as I demonstrated to you earlier, the original on the server have S on the forensics, but my copy doesn't have S on forensic. Okay. That's great. If you go to court proceeding, to a trial, the differences between the original and copy could be an evidence. So, how to make sure? I mean, if you send the copy, you know, without S, the evidence can be judged as, I don't know what the legal term, but the court could not use that for evidence because it's different from the evidence should be presented on the trial untouched, okay, as in the original condition. If somebody tampered with the evidence, then the evidence will not be able to be admitted to the court. And that's become a problem. Okay, let's continue then. So there is a science, it's called computer forensic, that able to examine and authenticate, preserve, analyze data from computer storage. Okay, so what I'm saying was, with specific tools, this computer forensic expert can tell you which file is the original and which one is the copy. Or he can tell you how many copies have been made from the original file. Okay. Is this copy from the original or copy of the second copy, for example? There is a tools to find that, but it's not available and can't be used by people, ordinary people like us, for example. Information system controls, again, this has been discussed in accounting information system with general control and application control specific to application. Now, information system will have so many threats, will have so many things that can make them broken. What should we do? What should the company do? A company could, you know, could not prevent all of this. Okay. So we will, because again, if you want to prevent all the dangers, you want to cover or protect your company from all the dangers, it will be very expensive. Okay. And the resources of the company will not be able to cope with that. So we need to apply cost benefit principles here. Okay. And that's it's called a risk management. First, we need to assess the risk. What kind of type of threats that will be a danger to our system? For example, physically, do our system prone to electricity failure? Yes, it is. Okay, so we, and how probable in a year that we lost electricity many times. Okay, so we can use that, for example, this point. Probably of occurrence 30%. I think Indonesia could depend on the places, but it could be 50%, for example. Okay, the loss average is about $100,000, and expected annual loss is about $30,000. So to prevent or to cope with power failure, as long as we spend less than $30,750, for example, let's buy a generator, for example. How much generator costs? $10,000. Okay, so if we buy $10,000 and, you know, $5,000 for, you know, fuel and everything, maintenance, the total would be $50,000 per year, still smaller than $30,000. So yes, that's reasonable. We should buy generator to prevent or to cope with power failure. Okay. But if in order to prevent or to cope with power failure, we need to spend $40,000 a year, then that's not something that the company would do. Why? Because the cost to prevent this or to cope with this is bigger than the loss. So it's better we lost $30,000 rather than spending $40,000 a year. That's the way. And that's the risk management. So you identify the risk. How much will it cost us in a year? How much will it cost us to prevent or to cope with that or to mitigate that? If the cost to mitigate or cope with that is smaller than the loss, fine, go ahead. But if the cost is bigger, just, you know, accept that there will be value. And sometimes we didn't even have any measure to prevent some threat. For example, the threat of Mount Merapi eruption. Nothing we can do about it. We can't ask Mount Merapi not to erupt. We can't prevent eruption. We can detect eruption. We can estimate the eruption, but we cannot stop the eruption. So what should we do? If you prefer to stay in Jogja, then deal with it and accept it. Nothing we can do. But if you don't want to deal with it, we need to move away from Jogja and the ridge of Mount Merapi. Somewhere in East Java, for example. And then there is security policy. Security policy is policy to make sure the security. There are, within the security policy, there is acceptable use policy. What is it? This is define the acceptable use of firm information resources and computing equipment. For example, let's get back to the internet facilities provided by our campuses. internet connection. The acceptable use policy said the internet connection in provided by the university to students are for academic purposes. So it should be used for academic activities. Playing games. Okay, let's use this as discussion. Gladys.
Yes.
Okay. So internet connection at our campus is for academic purposes. So in your opinion, is playing online game should be allowed or not?
I don't think it will allowed.
Okay, so it should be prohibited?
Yes.
Okay, good. In general, yes. But what if our next door neighbor, the Faculty of Industrial Engineering, having game development courses? Obviously, they need to play games to understand how to create a good game, right? They need to understand how, and even though, even if they're not playing the existing online game, when they try to play the game that they develop, they still need to play the game. Okay. So if that's the case, that's why it's called policy. It's not a yes or no regulation. It depends. Okay. Again, for examples, looking at human anatomy. Okay. Is it good things? Should we, or let's just be blunt, looking at naked people? It depends. If it's for accounting students, I don't think so. At least as far as I know, there is no relation between the picture of naked people with accounting. Okay. But if it's for Faculty of Medicine, obviously, they need to learn about skin, they need to learn about human anatomy, they need to learn about deformation of human anatomy. So that's okay. Many years ago, when there is some YouTube video that felt that the Indonesian government felt that it was inappropriate, the Indonesian government actually blocked YouTube. Okay, so the all over Indonesia could not access YouTube. And you know who protests hardly, you know, early on? Muhammadiyah Yogyakarta University. Why? The content that the reason for YouTube blockage by the Indonesian government was content that deemed as what do you call it? It's a blasphemy, religious things, and Islam religious things. I can't remember what exactly. I think it's some movie about the Prophet Muhammad. And yet, Muhammadiyah Yogyakarta University, the one who protests. Why? Because they have YouTube channels in that. Okay. And that YouTube channel was used by the communication department for academic purposes, for having UMY TV. If it was blocked, how could the students having experience? And it was before the time of, you know, TikTok or Instagram, still just YouTube. Okay, let's get about C. I think that's it for today. Okay, any question? No? Okay, I left an assignment. on course site, situs kuliah. So this is about mobile phone security. So select one of the cell phones or smartphone owned by your group members, then look for information on security issues or vulnerability for that specific mobile phone. Okay. And then you need to know how to overcome the security weaknesses. Okay. It's group effort and it's due next week. Any questions?
No, teacher.
Okay, so that's it for today. Take good care of yourself and see you next lecture. Good morning.
Thank you, sir. Have a nice day.
Thank you, sir.
You too.